This is the Tanakh, the Jewish Bible. And the word Tanakh is an acronym that stands for three different words. Torah, the law of Moses. Nevi'im, the prophets. And Ketuvim, the writings. Depending on how you count, there are 24 books in the Tanakh. So let's take a look at what the Tanakh is, and we'll begin with that three-part structure of Torah, law, Nevi'im, prophets, and Ketuvim, writings. As it turns out, the name Tanakh itself is relatively recent, relatively modern. The ancient rabbis, for example, never said, "Oh, as it's written in the Tanakh." They would simply say, "As it's written, Kakatuv." The earliest text I was able to find that actually has the acronym Tanakh is the Second Rabbinic Bible of 1524 to 1525, one of the most influential Bibles ever printed. And in the Masorah notes in the margins of this text, you can find the acronym Tanakh, the Torah, the Nevi'im, and the Ketuvim. And as it turns out, these terms Torah, Nevi'im, and Ketuvim are ancient and very old. For example, in the Talmud, Yerushalmi, Megillah, we find that the sages say that the Torah, the law, and the prophets, the Nevi'im, may not be written on one scroll, but that the prophets, Nevi'im, and the writings, Ketuvim, may be written on one scroll. And the earliest example of Torah and Nevi'im we have comes from Ben Sira in the 2nd century, around the year 180 BCE. That's during the Second Temple, when he writes that the Jews had books including, quote, "the law, the Torah, and the prophets, the Nevi'im, and the others that followed them." And those other books are probably the Ketuvim, the writings. So all in all, the names Torah, Nevi'im, and Ketuvim are quite ancient, but the actual acronym Tanakh first occurs in writing that we can point to in the year 1524. At this point, I would just like to briefly mention that I teach Biblical Hebrew to students from around the country and around the world at the Institute of Biblical Culture. If you are interested in reading the Tanakh in the original Hebrew and would like to study with me, check out biblicalculture.org, where you can sign up for one of my courses. So, is the Jewish Tanakh the same thing as the Christian Old Testament? Now, people like myself often use these terms interchangeably just because it's quick, it's easy. But if you kind of slow the tape down and take a close look, these are not exactly the same. The Jewish Tanakh is different from the Christian Old Testament. So let's take a look. The language of the Tanakh is strictly Hebrew. Sure, you could have a translation, but the main base text is the Hebrew. Whereas in different Christian traditions, certain Old Testaments are actually based on Greek, Latin, or Aramaic. So these are one language removed from the original Hebrew, but the Jewish Tanakh always works off the Hebrew. When it comes to the order of the books, the Old Testament is very different from the Tanakh. The Old Testament follows the ancient Septuagint translation, the Greek translation of the Jews of Alexandria. And what it does is it divides all the books into four sections. The first is the Pentateuch, the Torah. The next section is the rest of the history of Israel. So that's the Book of Kings and Chronicles and so on. The third section is poetry and wisdom. And that would be books such as Psalms and Proverbs. And then finally, the fourth section is prophets. When it comes to the Tanakh, the order is, as the name suggests, the Torah, the Nevi'im, and the Ketuvim. The Torah, the prophets, and the writings. And the prophets, as many know, are not just about prophecies. There's a lot of history there. And the writings contains a lot of prophecies. So it's not really clear what these three-part division means. My best guess is that the Ketuvim, the writings, were the last books to be finished or included in the canon of ancient Israel. So you might ask, what does the order matter? Is it important? And the answer is yes. So in the Tanakh, for example, the Book of Ruth is in the Ketuvim, the writings, and it's grouped together with four other scrolls, the Megillot. And each of these scrolls is read at a certain holiday during the Jewish year. The Book of Ruth, for example, is read on Shavuot, the Feast of Weeks. Whereas in the Old Testament, there is no such thing as the Megillot, and the book of Ruth simply follows the book of Judges in the history section. Conversely, in the Old Testament, the last book of the Old Testament is the book of Malachi. And because of this important position, the book of Malachi has been interpreted often as being a forerunner to the books that follow the New Testament. Whereas in the Tanakh, Malachi does not occupy an important position, and certainly not looking towards the New Testament. Now I'd like to speak about what is probably the most glaring difference between the Tanakh and the Old Testament. There are 24 books in the Tanakh, depending on how you count, but in the Roman Catholic Old Testament, there are 46 books, and the Eastern Orthodox have around 53 in their Old Testament. All of these extra books are called Apocrypha in Protestant Bibles, and these Apocrypha are not counted as part of the Old Testament. And the Protestant Old Testament is actually the most like the Tanakh. Even though it has 39 books, those are essentially the same books as the Tanakh's 24. There's just a different way of counting them. So depending on which Old Testament you're looking at, there are going to be more books in the Old Testament than there are in the Tanakh. There's one last point to discuss when talking about the differences between the Tanakh and the Old Testament, and that's the name Old in Old Testament. The reason that very few Jews use the term Old Testament is because it implies that it's old, just waiting for something new, being the New Testament, when obviously in Judaism, the New Testament is not considered part of the Tanakh. So if you would like to study the Tanakh, the Torah, Nevi'im, and Ketuvim ordered in this way based on the Hebrew, then you should definitely get yourself a Tanakh as opposed to an Old Testament. And when you study this book, you'll be studying terms and texts that have been used for thousands of years, even though the actual acronym Tanakh came in the last millennium. Thanks for watching. If you would like to study Biblical Hebrew, go check out BiblicalCulture.org. Otherwise, I hope to see you next time.